Now we move on to the last part of this lecture and see how the spin and orbital degree of freedom work together to stabilize magnetism in matter. We will be interested in two main classes of materials, the transition metals and the rare earth metals. We will also review the magnetic exchange interaction that exists in magnetic materials and see what kind of magnetic configuration they promote. Let's first look at the rare earth series. As we have seen previously, the magnetic moment of an atom is given by its total angular momentum, J. More specifically, it is proportional to the square root of J times J plus 1. In the case of rare earth, the electronic configuration is based on the xenon configuration, so 2 electrons on 5s and 6 electrons on 5p. The additional electrons occupy the 4f orbitals. Using Hund's rule, as discussed previously, the spectroscopic terms can be determined. Now, I can use the total angular momentum and compute the magnetic moments of each rare earth ion. Interestingly, this magnetic moment corresponds fairly well to the one obtained experimentally, except for samarium and europium. This discrepancy is related to the fact that they possess quite a small total angular momentum, so that Hund's rule does not apply as rigorously. Now we move to a different case, the 3D transition metal ions. Their electronic configuration is based on the argon configuration, and the additional electrons occupy the 3D shell. Again, we can determine the spectroscopic terms using Hund's rule, and we can also compute their magnetic moment using their total angular momentum J. Now, remarkably, this does not correspond at all to what is experimentally observed. Actually, the observed magnetic moment corresponds to the spin contribution only. So everything works as if the orbital momentum were quenched. This is really a fascinating situation that we will look into more closely in the next lecture. In addition to the quenching of the orbital momentum, transition metal alloys exhibit another intriguing property. It seems that their magnetic moment is simply proportional to the number of valence electrons, independently of the transition metal elements of the compound. To see that, I'm going to consider a diagram that reports the magnetic moments of the alloy versus the average number of valence electrons of the compound. This diagram is called the Slater-Pauling diagram. So first of all, I represent the magnetic moments of the elemental iron, cobalt, and nickel by open white squares. And let's mix up iron with nickel. Iron is already a strong ferromagnet, so if I mix it with nickel, I add more electrons to the D shell. These new electrons must be in the spin-down state, and therefore I should expect a reduction of the magnetic moment. And this is what I get. I can also mix up iron with cobalt, or nickel with cobalt. It works all the same, and the three curves superpose with each other. So what it seems is that what really matters is the number of valence electrons. To understand this, we can adopt the so-called rigid band model, which simply counts the number of electrons per band, up and down, without worrying about anything else. The largest magnetic moment I can get is a high spin configuration, where all 5 electrons are up. Any additional electron must be down and then reduce the magnetic moment. So if I do that, I find that the magnetic moment decreases with the number of valence electrons. Now, let's look at the other part of the diagram. When I mix a strong magnet with a D-shell that is more than half filled, with elements with a D-shell that is less than half filled. For instance, let me mix chromium with iron. Iron has 6 electrons in its D shell, while chromium has 4. So the more chromium I mix, the smaller the magnetic moment. It works all the same way if I mix vanadium with iron, but also if I mix chromium or manganese with cobalt. The more chromium or manganese, the lower the magnetic moment. Same story for nickel mixed with chromium or manganese. I can use the same rigid band model, starting from iron. The iron shell corresponds to a total number of down electrons of 3, which results in a positive slope as a function of the number of valence electrons. This diagram is quite useful to gain a phenomenological understanding of the magnetism of transition metals. One can go one step further by noticing that the left part of the graph gathers compounds with a low number of valence electrons, displaying BCC crystal structure with more localized magnetism, while the right part of the graph gathers compounds with high number of valence electrons, higher packing, HCP or FCC, and displaying itinerant magnetism. Now this estimate is of course quite rough. It gives some good rule of thumbs. For instance, the magnetic moment of an alloy with 50% iron and 50% nickel is indeed equal to that of a pure cobalt. This works well, but if one looks at the magnetic moment of bulk iron, it is clearly underestimated. In addition, you can notice in several places substantial deviations from the linear behavior deduced from the rigid band model. These discrepancies are attributed to the fact that we neglected hybridization between the D, S, and P electrons, as well as structural and magnetic phase transitions. This simple rule is not just limited to transition metals, and it also drives the magnetism in Heusler alloys. These Heusler alloys are ternary alloys on the form X2YZ, made out of 4 interpenetrating FCC lattices. The X and Y elements are magnetic and can be coupled ferromagnetically or anti-ferromagnetically. A parent family of the Heusler alloys is the half-Heusler alloys, where the X atom only occupies half of the tetrahedral interstitial sites. In the particular case of half-Heusler compounds, only manganese and rare-earth-based alloys display localized magnetism. What is particularly interesting to us is that the magnetic moment of both Heusler and half-Heusler alloys is simply proportional to the number of valence electrons. They are on the left part of the Slater-Pauling diagram and display localized magnetism. Let us move on and discuss a bit further about the very nature of the exchange in magnetic materials. In the previous lecture, we have seen that the direct overlap of the wave function of neighboring atoms can lead to direct magnetic exchange that we call Heisenberg exchange. Now, this is not the only way to get magnetic ordering. For instance, if you consider magnetic impurity in a sea of itinerant electrons, this impurity will induce a damped oscillating spin density around itself. In other words, the magnetic impurity polarizes the surrounding electron gas, and the polarization decorates the magnetic impurity by displaying this oscillating character. This oscillation, which is called Friedel oscillation, is quite similar to the riddles created by dropping a rock in water. The Friedel oscillation of the spin density creates a long-range oscillating magnetic interaction that can be positive or negative depending on the distance. The exact formula is given here in terms of the Bessel function and reporting on the right diagram. So, if two neighboring impurities are close to each other, they will align ferromagnetically. If they are a bit further apart, their coupling end up being weak and anti-ferromagnetic. Even further away, the coupling becomes even weaker on ferromagnetic, and so on and so forth. This mechanism was proposed by Ruderman-Kittel-Kasuya-Yosida and Kasuda, and is referred to as the RKKY coupling.
It explained the magnetic ordering in alloys composed of localized magnetic moments embedded in a sea of itinerant electrons, such as rare earth alloys and diluted magnetic semiconductors. Another exchange mechanism that can be found in magnetic oxides is the superexchange interaction. This one occurs when two magnetic cations of the same valence couple through an oxygen anion. So there is no direct overlap between the orbitals of the magnetic ions. The coupling is mediated by the 2p orbital of the oxygen anion. This effect results in different types of exchange interaction depending on the filling of the 3D shell. For instance, if the D shells of the two magnetic ions are half filled, then the magnetic moments couple strongly through the p orbitals of oxygen. Since the valence electrons occupying the oxygen orbital must be antiparallel with each other, the coupling between the two magnetic ions is antiferromagnetic and strong. If one shell is half filled while the other one is either fully occupied or empty, then the coupling is weak and ferromagnetic. Notice that the nature of the exchange interaction depends on the overlap between p and d orbitals, and as such, it strongly depends on the angle formed by the two magnetic ions on the oxygen. A variation of this mechanism was proposed by Zener in the case where the two magnetic cations are in a different oxidation state. In this case, the coupling through oxygen p orbitals results in a transfer of electron from one magnetic cation to the other. The resulting coupling is mostly ferromagnetic, but other forms of coupling can be obtained, such as antiferromagnetic or spin spirals. The different exchange interactions we have seen, direct exchange, RKKY, superexchange, and double exchange, all favor a collinear magnetic configuration, so either ferromagnetic or antiferromagnetic. In materials lacking inversion symmetry, an additional interaction emerges that favors perpendicular orientation of the magnetic moments. This interaction has been originally predicted by Dzyaloshinskii and Moriya in the context of MOTS insulators. It has been recently extended to spin glasses and, most importantly, to interfaces. This interaction favors non-collinear configurations such as spin spirals or magnetic skirmions. We have seen interactions that favor collinear configuration. We have seen one that favors perpendicular configuration. But what happens when several competing interactions are present? Or even simpler question, what happens where not all the interactions can be fulfilled? For example, for the sake of the discussion, let's look at a trimer with one magnetic moment at each vertex. And let us consider that the exchange is antiferromagnetic. In this case, if all three magnetic moments are parallel, none of the antiferromagnetic interactions are fulfilled, and the trimer is in a high energy state. To lower the energy of my trimer, I need to flip one moment. The lowest energy configuration I can get is either this one, or this one, or any other configuration where one spin is antiparallel to the other two spins. You see that this constraint is coming from the geometry itself. So overall, the lowest energy state is six-fold degenerate. Now, imagine that instead of a trimer, I have a macroscopic sample with these magnetic frustrations. I end up with a highly degenerate ground state, which is nothing but the definition of a spin liquid. And this spin liquid can produce non-collinear magnetic configurations and supports exotic fractional excitations. Here are a few examples of frustrated magnets, that is to say, magnets where all interactions cannot be completely fulfilled at once. For instance, iridium manganate 3 is an antiferromagnet with non-collinear coplanar configuration, where the spins form an angle of 120 degrees with each other. More complex textures, called 3Q textures, can be found in two or three dimensions. For instance, the example I give here is the configuration you get when you deposit a monolayer of manganese over copper 111. You can also obtain this configuration in three dimensions in gamma iron manganese. Pyrochlorous magnets are also the host of very interesting mechanisms, including magnet Hall effect and magnetic monopoles. Other materials like strontium cuprates host one-dimensional anti-ferromagnetic chains, and as such, they support so-called spin-ons, which are fermionic spin excitation. And to finish this very quick overview, some materials like alpha ruthenium chloride host even more exotic quasi-particles called Majorana fermions. These frustrated magnets and these fractional excitations are out of the scope of this lecture, but they nicely illustrate the diversity of magnetic materials.
This concludes our first lecture on the origin of magnetism in matter. In the next lecture, we are going to investigate the nature of itinerant magnetism in transition metals. We are going to particularly look at the role of the band structure, the influence of the interfaces and how it changes magnetism, the magnetic anisotropy, and the Dzyaloshinskii-Moriya interaction. So let's move on.